want to talk to you about what makes God rejoice. You want to make God happy? Yes. Come on, you guys. Some of you guys are really helping the preacher up there at camp. Now, I want some help. Okay, good deal. Let's get with me. Thank you. Yeah, we want to make God happy. What makes God happy? He says, this is what Jesus said. There is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents, over one person who comes to Christ. Heaven's rejoicing. That's what makes God rejoice. And I want us to look at that scripture a little bit more. This is what Jesus said. What do you think? If a man had 100 sheep and one of them goes astray, does he not leave the 99 and go to the mountains to seek the one that is straying? And if he should find it, assuredly, I tell you, I say to you, he rejoices more over that sheep than over the 99 that did not go astray. Even so, it's not the will of God, your Father who is in heaven, that one of these little ones should perish. Now, listen to the story dramatized.
What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he loses one of them, if not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? Shoulders rejoicing. When he cometh home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which I have lost. I say unto you, that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth, more than over 99 just persons which made no repentance.
There's an old song that probably most of you kids haven't ever heard. It's a good one. Some of us older ones remember it, but it tells a story in song. There were 99 that safely laid. But first of all, the story was not just about poor naked sheep. The story Jesus told was about lost boys and girls and men and women who need someone to help them find their way to God, and how God rejoices when they are found. Let's listen to this old song, and the words will be there, but it's a story in song.
This sheep of mine has wandered far from me, and although the hills may be rough and steep, I go to the desert to find my sheep. I go to the desert to find my sheep.
By blood of the ransomed river, how deep.
Rejoice with him. He brought back his own. Praise God. Well, last Monday, because of your financial help and the prayer and prayers, we took a number of our kids to Camp Anderson in hopes that some of God's lost sheep would be found. Camp Anderson is not just about fun and games, although there's lots of that. The two services each day were awesome services, and the kids got really involved in worship and listening to the messages of God's Word. But there were some fun. But here's the Camp Anderson vision: to build a Christian youth camp ministry in which thousands of young people can come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ that will impact our community and nation. And that's what's really happening. I want you to look at their summer camp. Their dates, they start in June 5 to 9, and then June 12 to 16, June 19 to 23, and right on through until August the 4th. Every week from June 5, they have 400 kids or more. You multiply 9 camps times 400 kids, that's 3,600 kids that come through that camp in the summer months. Besides that, they have lots of other activities, retreats and outreaches men's retreat. They're going to have another one coming up in March that we're going to be talking about, and the ladies' retreat, and a lot of exciting things that happen. But this is geared towards reaching people. And the summer camps, over close to 4,000 kids come through and hear the gospel. And a lot of those kids come from homes that have no love. A lot of those kids are coming from homes where they've been taken away from their parents because their parents are doing drugs or whatever, and they come without a gospel background. And Camp Anderson on the beautiful Suwannee River produces a fun and exciting place for kids to seek, or for people, for us to seek for the lost sheep. They had a nice swimming pool. I think they taught some snorkeling there besides swimming. And then, here's one of the fun things. Being dragged on a tube behind a fast boat. These are some of our kids getting on. Gives a little more volume here, David, because they're telling them they want to go fast, fast, fast. Someday I'm going to find the carpenters in this in the church, and we're going to build one of these carpet ball game things. They're not that hard to build, I'm sure, but the kids had a lot of fun. And in Brooklyn, I'm going to brag on a little. She was one of the experts. I don't know who was second runner up to being the top. Everybody, all the boys back there think they were the top winners in carpet ball. But there were some sleepyheads at times or two. They got tired and worn out. Took a table to sleep on and get some rest, and they did get to ride the big wheel bikes and have fun out there in the woods. And let's go on. The blob was one of the popular things. Now, some of us older ones may not really appreciate this so much, but it was fun for the kids that were willing to do it. Yes. Well, you saw that one pushed off. Okay, the heavier the weight coming down, but usually the higher the launch. And Nicholas Longo and Destiny McLean, and over on the other side, Mark and Dylan, and the kids were out there. They went down the river and went to Fanning Springs, which is crystal clear water, and they did some snorkeling and swimming there in the water. And that was one of the fun things. Avery found some friends. And these kids came all the way from Texas to attend the camp. But you know that one of the furthest away place people came from? Shanghai, China. There's a team of, 19 or so? People that came from Shanghai, China to attend the camp, Anderson. And China is not exactly a Christian country, but they certainly got a lot of Christianity in the camp. And we got a chance to meet several of them, but they were there. Here's some other scenes. Sitting by the picnic tables, and then some guys got into paint. And they really got into paint. The kids had fun with the paint. Some of them were starting to look a little bit weird, but it did finally wash off. But, you know, here's some of the fun of getting painted up. And let's see what we have here. Well, we got Elena and Destiny. And they were getting into the paint. Here's, you can hardly even recognize Madison there with all that paint on. But Nicholas is giving Destiny a hair job, put paint in her hair. Thank God it washed out afterwards. But anyway, Kayaking was another great fun thing. Look at the river there. And the kids could go through some of the swamps and ride the kayaks and get down on the river and have a lot of fun. And there was a law that everybody had to have a life jacket on before they stick a toe in the water, except for baptism day. And if you notice that my wife's back in that picture, she got out on the kayak as well. Okay.
Are you ready?
Here's tug of war. The losing side falls into the mud pit.
Yeah.
And boys lost.
Are you ready? Hey, I've got a purple estrogen just went up on this side. All right, here we go. Here we go. In 3, 2, 1, pull! Pull up! Pull up! Come on, girls! Pull! Fire! The boys, they got it! The boys came together! The boys are gonna lose! The girls have taken the mud pit!
Well, we had to show the girls winning, because that wouldn't have been nice. Boys won sometimes too, but anyway, that was fun. And then here we are with some of our kids sitting in rows getting ready for the service. And remember, there was a service every morning and a service every night. And there was some great music. Here's fun. Praying for those who haven't come to Christ, but many did. Why is heaven rejoicing today? Statistics for Camp Anderson for our, the time we were there, July 10 to 14, 74 new decisions for Jesus Christ. 74 new kids gave their life to Christ during that time. 28 rededications to Christ, and then 49 were baptized as a testimony for Christ, that they gave their life to Christ there during the camp. They said that that was the highest record number for one of their camps, the 74 that gave their lives to Christ during camp. So no wonder heaven's rejoicing. And we have a right to rejoice as well, rejoice with him. Now we don't have, this was last year's picture. We did this again this year, but and we had on these shirts, but we haven't gotten the pictures yet. They've been very busy back to back, week after week, and then they get the pictures and they try to send them out email to all of us who were there. But I haven't gotten them yet, so I put up the last year's picture, but this just shows some of the crowd of 400 kids that were there last year and again this year, and God's moving in their hearts. Now let me talk to you just a little bit about baptism. Baptism does not save you. You get baptized to show you have been saved. It's a testimony to your salvation, something on the inside. And when you get saved, when you call on the name of the Lord in faith and receive forgiveness for sins and a new life. And here's the scripture, that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised you from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes to righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Salvation comes by confessing our sins and putting our faith and trust and calling on the name of the Lord to save us. That's when we're saved. Then 2 Corinthians 5, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creature or new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. This is also symbolized by baptism. Going under the water shows the old past is dead and being buried. And coming up out of the water shows the resurrection, that we are becoming a new creation in Christ Jesus. And that's the symbolism of baptism. It's a testimony of something that God has done on the inside. Baptism is an outward sign, a testimony to an inward work of Christ that he's done on the inside of us when we repent and trust him and believe in him. In Colossians 2:12, for when you were baptized, you were buried with Christ in baptism. You were also raised with Christ through your faith in the active power of God who raised him from the dead. So we believe in baptism. Not that baptism saves us, but that baptism is a testimony that we have been saved. And when the kids came forward to give their lives to Christ, and after they had prayed together, then they went back to meet with their counselors, and they had a card to fill out. They were given a card to fill out, and it said, I have made a decision to follow Jesus tonight. And then there was another place to check. I have been rededicating my life to Christ. And the third one was, I would like to be baptized as a testimony to my new faith in Christ. And if they checked that, then the kids were eligible to be baptized. Then they asked the pastor, was it okay for them to be baptized there at the Swanee by the camp or at the camp? And then we contacted parents to get permission from parents for the kids to be baptized from their parents. And once that permission was granted, they were put on the list of the kids that would be baptized. Now, again, they videotaped all of that, but we don't have that. I'll show that to you. Maybe by next Sunday I'll have the pictures of the kids that were baptized in the river. And I baptized four of the kids, and one of our kids, one of the camp counselors to baptize them, which was fine. And so we had five of our kids baptized there. Now, because baptism doesn't save, we're not saying people are getting saved over again, but baptism is a testimony. And 400 kids watched as some of our kids gave their testimony in baptism at the river up there on Friday. But some of our kids want to be baptized here today as a testimony before you all that their lives have been transformed and have been changed. And we're going to do that. Now, those of you sitting right in the middle may be hard for you to see, but if you'll move over to the outer edges of the of this row here, and those over there will be able to see. We're going to go into and have a baptism. Two kids today, and then probably two or more next Sunday because their parents weren't able to be here to see, to observe their baptism today. They would like their parents to be able to see it. So we're going to have some more probably next Sunday, and we've cleaned out the baptistry. It's got fresh, clean water, probably a little chilly, but it's there. And we're going to get in it here in just a moment. But as we move and transition into that, there's a song that I want to play. It's called Thank You for Giving to the Lord. But remember, kids, contact my wife or me if you want to go with us Wednesday afternoon. We'll be leaving to go up there for the service. We'll just get there for the church service and then come back. So we'll be getting in late, probably 11 or 12 o'clock, probably close to midnight. And way past my sleeping time, my bedtime. But we'll do it for you guys because we want you to be in that, in those services as much as possible. Okay? So let's go on. Well, here we are. This is our camper we got to stay in. Thank you to Reed and Suzanne for the nice place that my wife and I got to stay in during the camp. And let's transition then into the baptism time.
I know up in heaven,
You're not supposed to cry, but I'm almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand. You stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed.
Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so
Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.